Great to be with you in the second week of Lent. I have been looking at the book of Hebrews. We looked at that last week, and I want you to turn, if you have your Bibles with you, to chapter 2 of Hebrews, which is a little letter towards the very end of the Bible. If you go too far, you get to the maps. So it's just right there. We must pay more careful attention, therefore, to what we've heard, so that we do not drift away. Down a little bit, verse 3. This salvation, which was first announced by the Lord, was confirmed to us by those who heard him. God also testified to it by signs, wonders, various miracles, and the gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will. In verse 8, in putting everything under Jesus, God left nothing that is not subject to him. Yet at the present, we don't see everything subject to him, but we see Jesus. Pray with me. Lord, teach us from your word how we could pay attention and not drift, and how ultimately we would see you. We pray that you'd be present in our lives, that you'd be near, and that you would give us a fresh way of looking at our life, our relationships, who we are, and who God is. We belong to you, so teach us today in Jesus' name. Amen. I rarely preach out of Hebrews because it's kind of a strange letter, but I was caught by these verses, and I was down in San Diego about a month or two ago and visiting with my sister-in-law and my brother, and for you San Diego people, Ocean Beach, OB, okay, right there, by the pier, okay. So, that means nothing to you people.
I love Ocean Beach.
Okay. So anyway, we're talking, and I'm trying to, you know, be the good uncle, so I'm asking about how it's going with their kids, Tommy and David. And she said, you know, David has really found himself. He's become a drifter. And I thought, oh, then she said, and we're so proud of him. And I thought, these people are crazy. No wonder they're in my family. Why that must be unconditional love of the parents, you know, that they would love their son even though he's a drifter. Then I found out that drifting is this kind of underground car racing where you go and you build up a lot of acceleration and then you skid and you spin and you're doing all these different trick driving and stuff. And he's got a little red Ferrari and I guess he's a drifter. And they're proud of it. I thought a hobo with a napkin and a stick, you know? That's what I thought, and I think, well, good, our son's not that bad, okay, close, but, you know, and anyway, so he was a drifter, and it got me thinking, because this says, we have to pay more careful attention, therefore, to what we've heard, so that we don't drift away. I don't think this is talking about underground car racing. We have to pay more attention to what we've heard so that we don't drift away. I'm really captivated by that phrase, don't drift away. This is the only place in the entire New Testament where that phrase is used. The only place. And yet it's so vivid, right? What's it mean to drift away? Well, as I was studying about this, there's a couple of different mental images that come up. One of them is like evaporation, where you have like your water and you heat it up and it turns to steam and it drifts away, right? Until there's nothing left, you're burning the pan if you're not careful. And it's the kind of the sense of you're a person of substance and then you've lost your substance. You're no longer solid. The image I get is from that old movie Back to the Future where he's up playing the guitar, and he looks down, and his hand starts disappearing, and then his wrist, and then his arm, and he starts to become a non-substantive person, right? It's a drifting away. Another way that drift away is used is does it rain where you guys live? Well, let me talk for you. Does it rain where you guys live? You know, it's a, when the water comes down, we live on a, the bottom of this huge cliff, this wooded cliff. And not only the trees come down with the wind, but the water comes down too. And that fills up Damien's bedroom down at the bottom level. But the water comes and it becomes diverted by different things. And it doesn't just come straight down, but it makes its way and it diverts. It kind of leaks off different ways. And so the idea here is that one way that we can drift away is that we start to get diverted and we leak. We our attention goes to play things that are less important and we're not able to accomplish what we were made to be and to do because we've gotten off track a little bit. This, I saw this, I camp, Eileen, the one who got married, said one night of camping for every 3,270 nights on the executive floor of a Marriott. So we have one night, and then I'm almost up to the next one. It's 46 years, but I'm gonna get that night of camping with her. But I went by myself once up into Montana in an old 79 Country Squire that I was idiot to drive. Anyway, I had borrowed a Coleman stove from a friend in our church in Walnut Creek. In the original box. I mean, this was really cool Coleman stove. So I set it up, fixed it all up, and was gonna start cooking. And I couldn't get the burners lit, and then suddenly it went boom! And instead of the flames coming up the burner, they were coming up where the valve goes in from the propane tank. I guess I had it on incorrectly, okay? And so the flames are coming out at me and up to where the control is that would turn it off. So I can't turn it off, the thing's going crazy. And in that moment, as a man who's had one night of camping experience, I lost my presence of mind and I had a quart of milk. So I'm putting out the fire. Boosh, boosh, boosh. Well, milk does not put out gas fires, okay, first of all. But what it does is it burns onto the surface of the Coleman stove like a really bad melted marshmallow thing, you know? And then it hardens and becomes this impossible crust. And then you sit there and watch the flames until the tank burns out. I felt so sorry for the gentleman who had given me his Coleman stove. You want me to dust it off a little?
Well, it's defective.
It's defective. I know. Yeah. Yeah. Reminded me of that old joke, you know, where the guy jumped out of the airplane with a parachute and it didn't open and he's falling to his death and somebody passes him and he says, "You know anything about parachutes?" And the guy goes, "You know anything about Coleman stoves?" Okay, so that was off the subject. Okay, so anyway, when we get diverted, all this flame was coming out. It was diverted. It wasn't going up to the burner, so I couldn't accomplish what I had it there for, which was to cook my dinner. Couldn't even drink the milk after that. And then it had a lot of energy. It had a lot of heat. It had a lot of, firepower coming out at the wrong place. And that's what happens in our spiritual lives. When we get diverted and we find our interests and our abilities and our efforts and our concentration and our focus all go off and burn up uselessly. So he says, you've got to pay more attention to what you've heard so you don't drift away, so that you don't get diverted and burn up uselessly. The third one, the third image that we have here is pay attention because drifting involves momentum. And for Dan and my nephew, you know, they get up to high speeds and then try and turn their cars around, you know, basically. And they keep going. And sometimes momentum can be in an unhealthy way or in a wrong direction. And then we drift in a way that can be perilous to people and to ourselves. It can damage ourselves and we can hurt ourselves. We can hurt others because of the momentum that we picked up in an unhealthy way. So just pay attention so that you don't drift away, so you don't get so much momentum that you lose track. And I was trying to think of you know, when that happened to me, and I had this small group in California that we met for about 7 years on Wednesday mornings, and they were a tough group, and one of the last times we were together, we decided to go jet skiing up in a lake by Gold Country. And so we went to this lake and we were jet skiing. One of the guys had a trailer filled with jet skis. He had toys, you know. And I didn't know anything about jet skis, but they were fun. I'm putting around, you know. And then they decided, I think, to be mean to me. And I'm the pastor, you know, and they're being mean to me. And so they started, you know, you come by me and then kind of, you know, create a wave of water that washes over me, and I fall off, and I get back on, and then they come around the other side and knock me over the other side, and they're doing this for about 4 hours, you know, and I'm thinking, this is not as much fun as I thought it'd be, and then I got focused. It became payback time. We were doing one more few minutes of run around, and there was a guy named Dave Vreeland, who was in our group, who, was one of the meanest to me, really, you know. And I know it sounds like kids on the playground, but I was an adult, so. And I decided, I'm gonna teach him a lesson he will never forget. So he's sitting out there getting his stuff ready, he's about to go in, and I come at him full speed. I just picking up speed, just straight at him, making eye contact so he knows I'm after him, and he's looking at me, and then his eyes get bigger, and then he kind of gets this questioning look like, what in the world is the pastor doing? And I go right out, and I get just up to him, and then to splash him, I veered away. That's where I learned the scientific theory that an object in motion continues in motion. I'm not an engineer, but I discovered that because I had this visual picture of Dave Vreeland going airborne, like one of those movies, you know, stunt movies, where they're flying up through the air. And evidently, my jet ski, I turned and I was okay, but my jet ski went up over the side of his, shearing off the steering column like a beheading, and destroyed his jet ski. And everybody's looking at me like, why'd you do that? And I came around, he was in the water, and he's looking very concerned. And I said, are you okay? He goes, wait a minute. I go, what are you doing? I'm counting my fingers and toes to see if I have them all. Oh. See, when you get momentum, and you're going towards someone, something happens, and that is you keep going, even if it could have beheaded him. I could have cut him in half just like I sheared off the steering column. So let's be a lesson. Don't pick on a pastor. Now, so the Bible says we must pay more careful attention, therefore, to what we've heard so that we don't drift away, so that we don't create damage with the momentum that we have as we're going the wrong way, or we're doing things that are stupid or that are not going to be healthy and not going to end well. And sometimes it hurts others. Sometimes it's just stupid. I remember our theme we had for several years, the whole Bible in 6 words, God loves you, don't be stupid. That's the whole message of the Bible. And I'd bought a car. Eileen didn't have a driver's license when we met. She was 21, I was 17. She didn't have a driver's license. So on first Valentine's Day, I bought her a little red 59 Fiat, those little bugs, you know. It was red. We called it the cherry bomb. The engine would be on fire and people would run out for gas stations and throw water on the back, which is like putting milk on a Coleman stove. Anyway, the brakes went out on it, and I said, well, that's no problem. I'll just drive it home. Now, this is out of that category, God loves you, don't be stupid, okay? So I'm driving it home, and I think, you know, it's a little car. So if it was a red light or something, I'll just downshift, and then when I get close, you know, I'll just open the door. Have one of those suicide doors that look backwards, pulls you out, and then I'll just stop it with my feet. Like Fred Flintstone, you know? It worked for him. So I'm driving home, no brakes, and I see the signal up there turns, and this is in Lemon Grove, okay, it's Skyline Drive. So, okay, so I'm going down, and I see the signal, and the car's there, and they're all stopping, and I shift down, and then I shift down, and then I shift down, and I'm still going. And so I go, okay, here's the plan, open the door. You can't stop a car with your feet. I learned this. Smashed into the cars. Locked bumpers. The guy in front of me said, what's going on? He pulls me around the corner, dragging me around the corner into a gas station. He goes, yeah, what's the matter with you? You have no brakes? I go, yes, I have no brakes. And he looked at me like I was an idiot. And he disconnected the bumpers and he said, I can't believe this. And he drives off. So I continued driving on home. The thing is, when you're drifting, bad things can happen. And I think that's what the writer of our scripture is trying to tell us. We have to pay more careful attention to what we've heard so that we don't drift away. Now, then he goes on and says, how will we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? After all that God's done, and if you read this at home this week, instead, you'll see talking about the created world and how it was made and how we were to be the stewards of it and caring and nurturing and the land and all of these things. And yet in it we've drifted and we've lost sight and we've created a lot of damage along the way. And we've lost our bearings. And if we neglect such a great salvation that God has provided for us in Jesus Christ and in his life and his death and his resurrection and his spirit to us now, if we neglect this, it causes great damage. We've got to pay attention. And then he says what I think is one of the greatest verses in all of Scripture. Goes through this whole thing. We don't see everything, but we do see Jesus. We may not see everything. We may not know all the purposes. We may not know all the answers. We may not know what's going on, but we do see Jesus. And we need to pay attention to him. There was in one of the Gospels, some people came to Andrew, I think it was, one of the disciples, and they heard about what was going on and everything, and Andrew said, so what do you want? Why are you here? And their answer was, we would see Jesus. That's why we're here. And that's why we come to worship. I mean, we come for a lot of reasons, but ultimately, it's a chance to see Jesus. And why is that so difficult? What makes it so hard? Why do we lose our focus when we should be looking to Jesus and to his salvation and to his life for us and the forgiveness he brings and love, all of those things? Well, how can we lose track? And I was thinking about what goes on that we lose our way and we get distracted and we drift. And I realized, now last week I told you about my ADHD and how we have spiritual ADHD. We also get spiritual myopia. We get nearsighted in our life. And I'm physically nearsighted. You know, I don't see. You all can go now. I can't see you. But I can really see my hand, you know. But we get that way spiritually, where we get so focused on what's up close, our issues, our needs, our lack of something, our problems, our struggles. We look at that and we see that, and we lose sight of the whole bigger picture. We lose sight of Jesus because we're so nearsighted. Today I got a lot of stories, all bad, but I was thinking about this and when it really affected me. Now, a few years ago, when we were really young, we did a vacation with a purpose out at University Press, and the very first one we did, we went to Hawaii. That's a mission trip, right? Suzanne was there. Baron was there. Yeah, there were about 20 people in Hawaii, and I'd never been there, but I was the leader, you know. And so we get there, and that first afternoon, I went out to body surf in Waikiki. Waikiki, body surfing. I've waited my whole life for this, and I go out there. Now, because I'm so nearsighted, I swim with my glasses, and so I'm out body surfing, and a wave hits me from behind, and my glasses come off. First night in Hawaii, with 20 people wanting me to show them the island. Now I can't see anything. I can't see anything. And I've got a group of people going, hey, pastor, show us around. Stuff out there. That's about it. And began a desperate thing of trying to figure out how to get a prescription and glasses made and everything over there and instantly and those kind of things. And I think I got them back in time for the last day when we took a picture of the beach. I got a new pair of glasses. I was stone blind that week, could not see anything. And I realized that's how most of us live our life spiritually. Something comes along, hits us from behind unexpectedly, usually a hard thing, a tough thing, a bad thing, and we lose what we're holding on to see, and now we don't see anymore. We don't even know what to pay attention to because it's all just a blur. And we go through our life spiritually blurred out on everything instead of able to pay careful attention so we don't drift away. I think we have to get a cure for our spiritual nearsightedness. And one of the things, we do see Jesus, remember? We do see Jesus. And so one of the things that I love about the way Jesus connects with me and with all of us is that he begins really close. He comes very near. When we are at the bottom of the pit, we realize he's there with us. When we're struggling and grappling with issues that are beyond us, we realize, I'm there with you. And so the closer we look, all we can see, when you're nearsighted, you can see this. And we realize, if I just look up, Jesus, I can see Jesus, even in my nearsightedness, even in my spiritual nearsightedness, we can see Jesus. And then he helps us to look further and further, a little bit at a time, until we can see a bigger picture of what God has in mind. When he first made you, when he created you, when he thought of you, and before you were ever born, and he had an idea of what your life could be, and he loved you, and he knows you, and we've talked about this, and he calls you by name. We don't realize that until we see Jesus up close. And then he helps us see God's bigger plan. Pay attention. Pay attention to what you've heard. Pay attention so that you don't just drift away, being diverted or becoming less substantive or getting momentum in the wrong, in an unhealthy way. Pay attention. We may not see everything. We may not see a lot. We may not even know what it is we're seeing. But we do see Jesus. And if we stay focused there, then he'll give us the vision. He'll give us the vision to live way beyond ourselves. That's our message today. So let me pray with you. Lord, we need you, we love you, but Lord, we get off track so easily. Thank you that you do stay very near. You stay close. And you don't leave us or forsake us. And Lord, help us to see you. Your love and your care, your joy, your freedom, your hope. Lord, we pray that you would stay so close that we never lose sight of you. Give us the courage to trust you day by day. That's our need today. In Jesus' name, amen.